Brahms at the time when he was composing his third symphony, the highly respected Dr. Johannes Brahms. He had refused an honorary doctorate from Cambridge. He considered a postcard sufficient for this purpose, but he accepted one from the University of Breslau. The gruff, confirmed bachelor was kind to children and thrifty to the point of obnoxiousness. His clothes seemed to last forever. He was unimpressed by the Habsburg pomp, but the battledin of the Hohenzollerns elicited a victory song from this otherwise apolitical man. Brahms wrote patriotically to his emperor, "Most Serene Highness, most mighty and benevolent Emperor and Lord, the achievements of recent years have been so great and glorious that anyone not privileged to participate in these mighty battles for Germany feels all the more a deep-seated need to say and to show how happy he is to have experienced this magnificent time." What were, in fact, the so grand and glorious achievements of recent years? The buildings of the Wilhelminian era housed a self-assured bourgeoisie. The modesty with which the kitchen help had to make ends meet contrasted sharply with the pompous furnishings of the drawing rooms. The salon, where the right people met, was the dominating social force. Monumental works were created in the painters' and sculptors' studios. Brahms treasured Max Klinger's etchings entitled Brahms's Fantasies, which were dedicated to him and his work. The unleashed forces of nature could not be portrayed dramatically enough. Storm-ridden mountain ranges, roaring torrents, all intended to carry a young genius who had ventured onto the rocky precipices of music to the greatest possible heights. Yet Brahms would surely have smiled at this memorial, finding as he did bombast of any kind repugnant. It is said that when facing a magnificent landscape or a pretty picture, he always asked companions for a Brahms quotation, and that he pouted when this request was not spontaneously granted. "My music," said Brahms, "is constantly compared with sunrises, rushing streams, tidal waves, and thunderstorms. Why aren't you singing now?" Brahms, famous though he was, did not, like Liszt, host a literary musical salon. It would have been unthinkable for him to gather admiring ladies or prominent members of the music world around him. Brahms lived, like a farmer from Schleswig-Holstein, 20 years in the same simple parlor furnished with second-hand furniture. There was no flair, no style, no indication that a great genius resided here. A genius who had, in Wagner, not only his opposite pole, but also his only worthy rival, who held court in Villa Wahnfried. The expert will recognize in this group of people some who also formed part of Brahms's circle. People fled from the oppressive plushness of the fin de siècle, the dust-catching furniture and fittings, and turned to nature. Brahms loved walking and rambling, as here with the poet Klaus Groth. The caustic pen of the caricaturist hit the mark in those days just as it does now. The nature-loving Brahms is often compared to Beethoven. Both found recreation in the country around Vienna. Brahms, out for a walk, became a local attraction. He loved company, especially in his close circle of friends, and preferably in his favorite local pub, the Red Hedgehog. There were no friendly gatherings in his flat. He enjoyed visiting friends and therefore occasionally forced himself into formal clothes when courtesy demands it, as here with his friends Hanslick and Billroth. Yet he was most at ease in the countryside, in nature. Behaglichkeit, or comfort, coziness, is said to have been one of his favorite words. It needed an invitation to a house concert from the highly esteemed Johann Strauss to persuade Brahms to face Viennese high society. But even then, he could not resist making snide remarks. His parting comment was, "If there's anyone whom I have not yet insulted, I beg forgiveness. Now I'm going to the Richard Wagner Society," by which he meant a certain well-known house of ill repute in the city. But even with the best of friends, he preferred one-to-one encounters, as here in summer at the Strauss Villa in Bad Ischl, or at a spirited game of cards with Strauss and the conductor Hans Richter. The profiles of Wagner and Liszt on the wall add a not unintentional touch of sarcasm. But perhaps the idyllic scene of Behaglichkeit and respectability that flows to us from Brahms's summer activities is deceiving. the striving citizen Brahms was seen in his own time as a self-taught man who missed no opportunity to further educate himself, investing his money in books, accumulating a considerable fortune as a pianist and conductor, and dictating his own prices to the publisher. That is one side of the coin. He chose loneliness. The other side of the coin reveals the fruits of this endeavor. Leonard Bernstein.
When you think of a composer, the image of a composer, what usually springs to your mind? A creature of mystery, someone who is endlessly secluded in the laboratory of his mind, in the workroom of his soul, and who unaccountably and magically comes out of it now and then with a newborn piece, isn't that so? Only think of Beethoven, Schubert, Scriabin, Ravel, Tchaikovsky, all men of mystery. But Johannes Brahms? You don't usually think of him as a shadowy magician, a witch at the bubbling cauldron. Brahms' music seems so accessible, so patently there for the taking, like a sumptuous banquet table laid out with everything rich and warm and nourishing. At least that's one way people have of regarding Brahms. For example, the symphony we're about to hear, the sumptuous Third Symphony in F. But I've always found Brahms' Third Symphony one of the most mysterious of all his works, full of strange contradictions and dualisms that reflect the various dualistic conflicts of Brahms the man. And as we know by now, dualism means ambiguity, and ambiguity means mystery. For example, let's look at the heroic opening theme of this symphony. Now that theme is ushered in by three mighty rising chords. Like a Homeric invocation of the muse. And the muse responds most generously, since that very three-note melodic rise will pervade the entire first movement. And in fact, the heroic theme itself actually takes off from the third note of the invocation. Did you happen to notice that three-note invocation figure down in the bass? Like an atlas supporting the powerful melody on top? There is a dualism for you right at the outset. And that's not all. Still, on page one of this incredible score, the conductor is confronted by a further dualistic problem, the tempo. Brahms has marked it allegro con brio, which means fast, with spirit. But how fast is that? Well, superficially understood, it looks something like a lively Viennese waltz. That is unfortunately how it's too often played. Alas, because there is much more on that first page to be studied by our conductor. First of all, we see in smaller type the word passionato, passionate. So we know Brahms has something more in mind than just a delightful Vienna waltz. First and most obviously, there is a continuing conflict, bar by bar, between major and minor. Major. Minor. A passionate dualism indeed. But the real secret is this. Brahms has indicated a meter of 6/4 time, that is 6/4 notes to a bar, or twice as many as are in a bar of a Wiener Walzer. Now, why didn't he write it in conventional 3/4 time if he was writing a waltz? The answer lies in the accompaniment. You have to look hard at the viola and cello parts. It's in all those notes throbbing away in between the heroic tune on top and the atlas figure beneath. There they are, passionately pulsing away in syncopation on every single beat, 6 times to the bar. Now that's anything but a waltz accompaniment. It's rather a highly charged underpinning for that passionato gypsy tune we know as the heroic theme. And now our conductor should know something decisive about the tempo. that the rapidity of the allegro refers to that pulse of 6 beats in a bar. Brahms wants you to hear that panting 6 fast times per bar, con brio and passionato. Which means that we must take a slower overall tempo than we would if we were just waltzing, which means in turn that this whole movement is going to have a somewhat longer duration. But it's well worth it, since it reveals the true dualistic Brahms, the North German classicist swept away to Vienna and fired by Danubian, Carpathian, and Gypsy passions. Another curious dualism, apropos of this same opening theme, at one mysterious point at the still center of this movement, we hear the melody very quietly like this. Haven't we heard that exactly like that somewhere else before, in some other symphony? Yes, of all places, in the third symphony of Robert Schumann, at the still center of his first movement. How strange that Brahms should quote that now, 30 years later, 3 decades removed from his short but traumatic experience with the love, madness, and death of Schumann. Obviously, Brahms is still haunted. The comfortable, solid citizen, bourgeois Brahms, is the image on only one side of the coin. Flip it over, and another cliché has been demolished. The ghost of Schumann inhabits Brahms like a dibbuk. Now, while we are speaking of such mysterious matters, permit me to add one more, a rather personal one. At the same time that we're celebrating Brahms' 150th birthday in this year of 1983, we are also celebrating the 100th birthday of this third symphony, which we're about to hear. By a curious coincidence, that year of 1883 also brought the death of Richard Wagner, the other reigning musical king of Europe, Brahms' anti-pope, so to speak. As you can imagine, the legend of their intensely bitter rivalry was quick to spring up and to last a surprisingly long time, considering the fact that it was invented mainly by critics and fans and the press in general. The truth is that Brahms and Wagner had a high mutual respect for each other, diametric opposites though they were in every way, musically, personally, sexually, and politically. Brahms was not much of a political person, but Wagner was, and he infused his great music dramas and his not-so-great prose writings with his well-known theories of pan-Germanic racism, supermanism, and anti-Semitism. He was a veritable prophet of Nazi philosophy. So now just think back a mere 50 years to 1933, when Hitler came to power. What a grimly appropriate 50th death year present that must have been for Wagner, wherever he was. Forgive me for heaping all these numbers and dates on you, but you should know by now how fascinated I am by numerical connections, and in this case, the connection is that 1933 was also Brahms' 100th birthday. So here am I, 50 years later, with Hitler long gone, a Jewish American about to conduct Brahms' Third Symphony with the same Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra that played its premiere 100 years ago in the same Golden Hall of the Vienna Musikverein, and, ironically enough, conducted then by a highly noted Wagnerian conductor, Hans Richter. And by a still stranger coincidence, this same year brings a new recording of Wagner's greatest opera, Tristan and Isolde, conducted by, of all people, me. More irony, perhaps. But music does make strange bedfellows, doesn't it? In truth, it makes us brothers in the loftiest Beethovenian sense. I leave you to ponder that, especially when you hear the magically healing final moments of this great symphony, when all the mysterious conflicts and ambiguities of the work come to sweet resolution and repose, like an epiphany of peace on earth.
A view of Brahms's living room. The obligatory bust of Beethoven over the grand piano, next to it a reproduction of Raphael's Sistine Madonna. A rocking chair, which, much to Brahms's delight, tipped over as soon as a guest tried to sit on it. The most remarkable piece among these modest furnishings, however, is the portrait hanging over the rocking chair of the Italian composer Luigi Cherubini, half covered up by Brahms because he couldn't bear the allegorical figure in the background. Why Cherubini? He was an admired composer whom Beethoven highly respected, whose significance, however, scarcely outlived his own time. As the director of the Paris Music Conservatory, he was considered the bastion of order in the French music world. "I am no more than the Cherubini of my time," Brahms said of himself, never letting on how much irony or how much truth this modest self-evaluation contained. Brahms respected Cherubini, but no more, as a keeper of order in a time threatened by often uncontrolled feelings. Apart from Wagner, Schumann and Chopin, he accepted no one but himself. And how much truth, and irony too, was contained in Wagner's remark about Brahms. One can see how much can still be accomplished within the old forms when someone comes along who knows how to handle them. Leonard Bernstein.
Thus begins the last movement of Brahms' last symphony, the crowning glory of his symphonic life, the Fourth Symphony in E minor. What a passionate rage inhabits those eight bars. What a desperate fury. And yet this final movement, this last will and testament, is perhaps the most strictly ordered and formally conceived of all Brahms' creations. Don't you find that a striking paradox, rage and orderliness in one? But it's precisely this paradox that reveals Brahms to us most clearly in all the duality of his nature. Here stands a master composer producing one classical symphony after another, a confirmed and determined classicist in an era when classicism had long since been swept away by the tides of romanticism that flooded Europe in the 19th century. Wagner was on the crest of his new wave, playing hob with tonality and the traditions of the opera house. Berlioz and Liszt were letting loose with dramatic, nay, theatrical symphonies, or so-called symphonies, to say nothing of new forms such as the symphonic poem, anything to break out of those confining walls of classicism. New forms, new colors, the use of voices, speaking or singing, solo or choral, new instruments, fancy percussion instruments like tambourines or whole batteries of kettle drums, offstage brass bands, program music, theatrical subject matter, melodrama, anything and everything. It was a free-for-all. The artist was the new god, or at least the high priest. The old laws were consistently being broken, only to be refashioned according to the individual artistic will or whim. And through all this, our Johannes Brahms stands firm in his old, well-worn coat, insisting to the very end on perpetuating the classical tradition of Mozart and Beethoven. His orchestra is still the orchestra Beethoven had used 60 years earlier. His addiction to the sonata form is unshakable. His symphonies remain firmly abstract with no extra musical content, no offstage bands, no special percussion, always the traditional pair of timpani. Oh, excuse me, in this very Fourth Symphony, he made one first and last exception. He used a triangle, heavens, a triangle, in the musically exuberant third movement. But that's as far as he ever went in the direction of special effects. What was he avoiding? Was he simply a classicist who had outlived his period, a has-been, a leftover, as his detractors would have it? On the contrary, it is precisely the other way around. Brahms was a true romantic, containing his passions in classical garb. It was clearly a case of self-limitation. The only question that remains is, why? Let's go back to that fourth symphony finale we were talking about. This remarkable movement is so classical, it is even pre-classical. In it, Brahms has had recourse to a Baroque form known as the Passacaglia, a form perfected by Bach before the symphonic concept had even burgeoned. The idea of a Passacaglia is to make a short, definite musical statement and then proceed to repeat it at will with constantly new variations, melodic or harmonic or both. This notion of continuous variation had always intrigued Brahms. It's to be found in all his music, but not until now had he ever expressed it so rigorously. He took as his model Bach's great C minor Passacaglia for organ, built on this famous 8-bar statement. Is followed by a succession of 8-bar variations too numerous to mention. Now, Brahms did the same thing with his 8-bar statement. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. With the ensuing variations ornamented by new counter melodies or figurations, or expanded into double slowness, or going into the major and back again into the minor, subsiding into momentary repose or gracefulness, then bursting out again with new fury, new rages. Perhaps the most remarkable thing about this movement is that it ends in rage and fury, in E minor, just as it began. There is no final repose, no glorious sunburst in the major mode, as we might expect. No, his last symphonic statement, and biographers tell us that he knew this would be his last symphony, is that clenched fist raised in hot defiance to the heavens. Just listen to that ending, that brief but shattering final coda. But classically contained. Whence the rage and whence the containment? What did this celebrated, comfortable king of Vienna have to rage about? So much. He raged against his native city of Hamburg, which time and again had passed him by when selecting their new conductor for their Philharmonic Orchestra, a position Brahms deeply coveted. He raged against the fates that had destroyed his adored Schumann, idol of his youth, after an all-too-brief relationship, and against the forces that had conditioned him to be incapable of happiness with a woman, of domestic bliss, of having children, and how he loved children. So much to rage about, and so much more we don't even know, we can only guess at. Thus, I believe, arose the absolute necessity for containment. Brahms was genius enough to be his own psychiatrist, unconsciously, of course. He set himself up as the guardian of musical order in an age of romantic disorder. But what he was really guarding was his own passions, those conflicts we've come to know that threatened to tear him apart. And so he invented that persona so familiar to his society and to ours. This amazing display of self-control, self-discipline, and self-containment probably saved his life, his sanity, and his God-given powers to fashion the music with which he enriched and ennobled the world. A young music-loving friend of mine who heard I was planning this Brahms cycle said to me the other day, "Brahms? I don't dig Brahms. He's too nice." I was astonished, of course, but in a way I know what he meant. The niceness, in the precise meaning of the word, the niceness of his formal perfection, the way every bit of every piece fits so wonderfully together with such ease and smoothness, the effortless counterpoint, the naturalness of transitions and transformations. But within that niceness, under that niceness, oh, what torrents, what storms, what revelations of the agonies and hopes and visions and rewards that all of us human beings share and understand in one another. We are all united in Brahms music. And my young friend, who is very young indeed, will one day come to share in these revelations with us. But you, lucky people, are about to share in them now.
Thank you. Thank you.